I travelled to Sumatra having been inspired by an internet campaign focused on the protection of the Tripa peatland forest, which is home to one of the few viable populations of the critically endangered Sumatran orangutan. In 1990, this forest was the size of Singapore and was home to up to 2,500 orangutan. Today, thanks to the destructive and often illegal practices of the palm oil industry, what remains is just 10,000 hectares, with perhaps 200 orangutan remaining. In the month before I left, an estimated 100 more orangutan had lost their lives as newly lit fires engulfed what remained of this fragile ecosystem. My first port of call was to meet with Ian Singleton, who runs the Sumatran Orangutan Conservation Programme. This organisation has rehabilitated almost 200 displaced or illegally held orangutan back to the wild and has been instrumental in the recent campaign to save Tripa.
Now, these orangutans are all like confiscated ex-pets. It's illegal to keep a pet orangutan in Indonesia, it has been for decades. So we work with the forestry department, we confiscate them, they come here, they go through the medical quarantine period to make sure that they're healthy. And then once they pass that and they're given a clean bill of health, they come up to these large socialisation cages, and this is where we kind of introduce them to other orangutans. Often the first time since their mother was killed, they're right in front of their eyes. But these guys are the lucky ones, yeah? I mean, most orangutans don't make it this far. These guys are, you know, effectively refugees from forests that no longer exist. Mostly because they've been converted to palm oil or something else. But most of the orangutans get killed in that process. And a few lucky ones, you know, the mothers of all these guys was killed. And these are the ones that were found sort of still alive when their mother fell to the floor or whatever after being shot. And these are the ones that get taken home and kept as pets and the ones that end up here. So these are the lucky survivors from that whole forest clearance process. And that's good left.
When was he rescued from Tripa?
2009. Yes. He's confiscated from the villager around Tripa.
Okay. I asked Ian to fill me in on some of the background information concerning the Tripa campaign and why, in his opinion, the conservation of this forest was so important.
I mean, the Sumatra orangutan only exists in Sumatra province and Aceh province, and most of them are in a thing called the Loser ecosystem. But on the west coast of Aceh, still within the ecosystem, is these three peat swamp forests, the Sinkil swamps, Kluwit, and the Tripa swamps in the north. Now, these three areas, they have unique populations of orangutans. They use tools. It's the only place in the world where they're known to make and use tools on a regular basis to get like honey out of tree holes and to eat the fruits that are particularly big and hard fruit called the Nisia fruit. But they also have the highest densities of orangutans anywhere in the world. I mean, I did my PhD there in the Suat swamps in the late 90s, and it really is true. You know, they have densities down there of up to about 8 per square kilometre. Now, compare that with most of Borneo, where the average is between sort of 0.5 and 1.5 per square kilometre, and most of Sumatra, where it's about 2 or 3. You know, these peat swamp forests are the kind of, you know, you could say the orangutan capital of the world, you know, by a long way. Now, the Sinkil swamps and the Kluwit swamps are, in theory, protected areas for several decades now. But the Tripa swamp was mostly allocated out to 5 palm oil companies in the 1990s. And they proceeded to clear some of the land, to plant some of it they hadn't got around to planting. And then Aceh was in a civil war, and all their activities ceased between like 1999 and 2005, just after the tsunami. And a lot of natural regeneration in these forests took place. I went down there just after the tsunami and found sort of natural forest regenerating up to 6 meters high in just 5-6 years. So that's when we decided that we would fight. You know, we had one last chance to save the Tripa swamps.
Here is a map of Tripa which shows its position within the boundary of the Lesser ecosystem, which is marked by the yellow line. This means that all forests within this area are protected and therefore their conversion to palm oil estates is strictly against Indonesian law. The current campaign is initially focused on the illegality of a 1,605 hectare concession to the palm oil company PT Calista Alam in 2011. This area is seen in red at the centre of the screen.
When the fires were going on in Tripa in late March and April, and the rate of forest clearance, if that hadn't been stopped very quickly and continued for the rest of the year, we would have lost all of the remaining 200 or so orangutans in Tripa by the end of 2012, without a shadow of a doubt. And it could have even happened sooner if one of these fires took off and burnt out of control. You know, the forest could have gone within weeks, not necessarily months.
Having spoken to Ian, I decided that I should visit Tripa for myself to see what the situation was like on the ground. On the way, I met with one of Ian's colleagues, Shane McGrath, who agreed to show me one of the areas that had recently been destroyed.
Yeah, I do.
Kalau nggak mati dia, makan nih sawit nih.
Oh, okay, across the palm oil plantation.
Yeah. We've arrived at the site where less than 1 month ago an adult male orangutan was evacuated due to him losing copious amounts of weight and there was no food left. He was eating the surrounding palm oil. To discover now there's another orangutan that's moved into the area. It's devastating to see because we already know there's no food here. We know this area is a problem. Since we were here last, this is new palm oil. These trees behind us that have been cut down in the last 4 weeks. But yet, now we see another orangutan at extreme risk.
As we walked deeper into this tiny remnant of forest, we heard a crash of branches up ahead. To our surprise, we discovered our second orangutan of the day. This time a fully mature male had also moved in to escape the encroaching devastation.
The kissing sound that the orangutan is making at the moment, as you can see by his body language, is not because he wants to come and give us a cuddle and a kiss. It's because he's extremely frustrated and agitated and uncharacteristic in natural circumstances. He's extremely irate because he's living in a tiny pocket of forest surrounded by palm oil trucks. You can hear one rolling past just behind him now. And to the other side, the sound of chainsaws.
Yeah, what we've got here is the orangutan's obviously coming down to eat because there's no food left or fruit left in the tops of the trees, which is uncharacteristic for the behaviour of the Sumatran orangutan. So what we're looking at is a situation that's just completely wrong and being forced by palm oil companies that you can hear clear felling forest in the background. What we need to do as a movement and as people is continue to put the pressure on SPY and the central government and the national police to do their jobs and to do their jobs as quickly as possible. Otherwise, we will be losing more orangutans in the meantime.
When we returned to the office, I asked Shane why he thought saving Tripa was so important.
My personal perspective is the orangutan is the reflection, the symbol for the forest, but it's not a battle for orangutans and it's not a battle for forest, it's a battle for human survival. It's the reason why the Norwegian government has put $6 billion into forest conservation is not because they want to save orangutans in the world's forest, it's because we're facing a climate crisis. That Indonesia is the third biggest emitter of carbon dioxide in the world. And it's not because they've got lots of factories or because they've got lots of cars. It's because every year they're burning thousands and thousands of hectares of forest, and especially in the peat forest, there's just massive amounts of carbon being emitted, which makes it so important. If anyone's going to have a child or grandchildren, like, what would you say to them now, and what would you say to them in 50 years' time? Like, we knew we were at a crossroads. We know we're at a crossroads now. Like, are our grandchildren going to come to our graves and present us with flowers, or are our grandchildren going to come to our graves and piss on them because we've done nothing?
Someone like you.